next speaker will be introduced by Dr. Rama Hassan from the female hall.
And she's the head of pediatric and neonatal division at King Fahad Military Hospital, Jeddah. She will speak to us about surfactant therapy. So please, Dr. May, you have 20 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Assalamu alaikum. I'd like to thank the organizing committee in order, you know, for such a wonderful invitation and a wonderful gathering. And I hope after all these wonderful talk that you said everything, gentlemen, so there's nothing left to say. But anyway, so I'm going to talk about surfactant therapy, and just to go through quickly history, you know, the surfactant has been talked about a long time ago from 1929, but it has been, the first trial was in 1980 in Japan. And since then, since then there has been like a swing pendulous from one side to another. So everybody was excited about it. So intubation, prophylaxis, rescue was the theme in the 90s, and then early 90s and the late 90s, NCPAP, though NCPAP has been there all the time, but people choose to ignore its value, unfortunately. And then in early 20s, they moved to the prophylaxis with nasal CPAP, late 20s, NCPAP alone, coming back a full cycle. And then today, we are swinging between NCPAP, NIPPV, and, you know, ensure surfactant in and out, or maybe we shouldn't do surfactant at all. And now we have a big dilemma, who should receive what and when. So RDS is still a major cause of morbidity and mortality in our population, our newborn population, and it's about 1% of the live births. There is like 30 to 40,000 cases annually. Antenatal steroids reduces the incidence and the severity of RDS, and RDS develops in approximately 50% of infants less than 30 weeks. So surfactant, like you've seen, it has been developed only for the treatment of neonates with RDS. It has a major breakthrough in neonatology over the past three decades, reduces both neonatal mortality and air leak by approximately 50%, and about 6% reduction in the overall infant mortality in the first year of life. There's no increase in pulmonary or neurodevelopmental problems at long-term follow-up, and its use has been expanded to include ARDS, meconium aspiration syndrome, pulmonary hemorrhage, pneumonias, and so on. And, you know, this is from the Vermont Oxford. As soon as the FDA approved, it has been, you know, used over the years. And then with the meta-analysis, it shows that it has, it favors, you know, decrease in the neonatal mortality. And overall survival of the very low birth weight infant increased over the years, and part of it is because of surfactant. So if we look at the surfactant, it's a combination of proteins and phospholipids, and every now and then they talk about something new. Apoproteins were the theme for a certain decade, and now they're talking more about plasmolugins. Plasmolugins is one of the phospholipids, and it has an effect as an antioxidant, and also it helps quite a lot in reducing the surface tension. So, and its content is very variable, you know, between different types of surfactant. So, you know, it decreases the surface tension, and, you know, it kind of, a lipid forms a monolayer at the air water interface, decreasing the you know, the surface tension, and it's just the one that helps in spreading it as a carpet is these plasmalogenes, and hence it moves the you know, pressure volume curve from totally atelectatic to opening up and ready to gas exchange. And these are the different, types of preparation of surfactant, and they are between synthetic and they could be bovine and non-bovine, and there is a different generic names, and different countries is producing. And each one has a different properties, and they differ with their physical composition, proportion of lipids and proteins, the plasmalogen content, the antioxidant content, dosing volumes, duration of action, and the onset of clinical response. And just to show you here the differences in the plasmalogens, for example, between the piractant and the calfactant. So you see that it's much higher in the piractant, and that may be responsible for the immediate improve in the pressure volume curve that you see when you administrate a different type of surfactant. Now, the antioxidant content also varies. So you see, for example, the piractant again has a higher superoxide dismutase, as well as the plasmalogen, and it might contribute a bit for, as an antioxidant, as you know, it has a contribution for predisposition for bronchopulmonary dysplasia. But we know that giving surfactant does not decrease the incidence of bronchopulmonary dysplasia. And also, this is just to show that, there is one study that I haven't seen a repetition that measuring the tracheal aspirate with high levels of plasmalogen, and they've shown in that study that it is associated with the lower PPD rates, but that's kind of a very small number of babies, and it was a prospective study. Also, the surfactant has an effect. It inhibits the growth of encapsulated organism bacteria. And, if you want to compare different products, the first studied information that with all the recommendation that the bovine is much better than the synthetic. So synthetic now, in the past, we used to have Exoserf, and that was the only product that's available in the kingdom, but it was synthetic, but now definitely the bovine is much better. And if we would like to compare between the different, bovine-driven, there has been earlier study by Bloom in 1997, comparing the two, the piractant with the calfactant, and it showed that calfactant is not very good for babies less than 600 grams, with a very high mortality. But when it was repeated by the same group, it didn't show the same finding. There was no difference. And actually, there has been multiple studies later on comparing the two products, and it didn't really show that there is a superiority in one versus the other. But it's something to keep in the back of our mind when we are treating the babies. Also, it can be also dose-related. So when you use a high dose, the effect is, the response usually, it might be better. Sorry. Okay. So, And then cost is always a question. And I remember when we used to do the prophylaxis versus the rescue, there was always, that which one is cheaper, which one is cost, is it really cost effective? So, there has been Hastings et al. They've looked at it from Florida, and the conclusion was that it doesn't matter, whether between the use of the piractant and calfactant, whether you use it as prophylaxis or as rescue. But apparently, calfactant was significantly more costly because of the greater product wastage. And Dr. Al-Faleh mentioned about the early intrathecal pudendocytes using the piractant as a vehicle to prevent, bronchopulmonary dysplasia in very low birth weight infant. It was a pilot study, and it showed that there is a tendency for reduction. So, to summarize, so if we want to choose which surfactant to choose, so though, you know, there has been a repetition with other multiple studies saying that that piroxicam is not really superior, but maybe piroxicam provides a survival advantage in infants less than 600 gram compared to calfectant. Calfectant treatment is associated with longer duration of effect. However, it's more expensive compared to piroxicam, and piroxicam treatment is associated with faster weaning of oxygen, less days on oxygen and mechanical ventilation, maybe less bronchopulmonary dysplasia, and shorter length of stay when compared to povectan. And the best timing is to give it less than 60 minutes of age. Now, it has been expand its use to meconium aspiration syndrome, congenital pneumonia, sepsis, you know, hypoxemic respiratory failure, viral pneumonia, pulmonary hemorrhage, surfactant dysfunction, and bronchiolitis. And, you know, why? Because when any one of those, whether it's infection, whether it's hypoxia, the inflammatory reaction, it inactivate the pneumocytes type 2 cells, and, you know, it interfere with the production, endogenous production of surfactant, and at the same time, with all the leaky capillaries that happen, then there will be inactivation of surfactant as well. And, you know, this is just, you know, surfactant treatment for respiratory failure in meconium aspiration and primary pulmonary hypertension sepsis, and we see that it decreases the need for ECMO, especially with meconium aspiration syndrome. Okay, so now we can't really speak the same language as we were do the same thing as we were doing in the 90s. Why? Because there is a new era, new RDS, the Elegon infants. Structurally, we're dealing with a more immature lungs. It's not a problem of surfactant only. There is a lot of antenatal influences, antenatal steroids. You know, our practices has changed as well. So what we're having now, we're having, you know, a group of babies that, you know, they react differently. And this is from a study of extremely low birth weight infant, 1,340. And you can see that there are some of them, they actually, you know, recover totally. And, you know, they have consistently low FiO2, and they have a chronic lung disease by 17%. Some, they actually deteriorate and get a chronic lung disease 51%. And, you know, some of them, they go into 67% chronic lung disease. Now, we don't know which one is which. So, you know, things were not dealing in the same way, and then we have to think of it in a different way. Majority of studies that can be used, and I've just shared it with you, they are in the 90s and the early 2000s. The antenatal steroid usage was low at that time. Early CPAP was rarely used, and resuscitation of extremely low birth weight were different. And most of the studies recruited babies by birth weight, making gestational age-based guidelines difficult. And if you look at this important study, because we always worry when we treat babies about the sequelae, bronchopulmonary dysplasia is a major sequelae, and as Dr. Al-Faleh mentioned, it's not only PPD, it's everything what goes attached to it. So if you look, the contributing factor, antenatal infections, antenatal steroids, you know, surfactant has a positive effect on it, the delivery room management, vitamin A, and early use of nasal CPAP. So if you look, you know, by giving antibiotics, antenatal antibiotic, you are actually decreasing, prolonging the pregnancy for more than 7 days, and, you know, decreasing the amnionitis as well. So that's a good thing for the babies. And the neonatal morbidity is actually less in the group that they received antibiotics. And antenatal steroids, corticosteroids, we know how valuable it is. It has an effect on both the respiratory, the neonatal deaths, as well as on the respiratory distress syndrome, the severity as well. So the mode of therapy, you know, Dr. Hani Lali is very passionate about CPAP. We all should be as well, but there are new modalities as well there in IPPV, and they showed that they are promising as well in, you know, favoring the decrease the need for ventilation. But, you know, ventilation and, but unfortunately, it does not have an effect at all on bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Now, one of the things that we worry about when we give surfactant is that we have to intubate the babies, and not only intubate them, when we intubate them, we have to ambu bag them. And this is by Bujarklo in pediatric research. It's quite an old study, but it just says it all, that these animals, they were actually given surfactant, and a group where they were bagged and the others, they were not bagged. And you can see the difference on histological. The babies that they were bagged, though they were receiving surfactant, the animals, they had a really bad lung. So it seems, yes, surfactant, and this is what we call volotrauma. So surfactant is a good thing, but the problem is with the mode of its delivery. We have to intubate, and we have to ambu bag in between. Then the same thing is the delivery room management. You know, it has a bigger issue on, you know, a great influence on the risk for PPD. And this is both from animal data as well as, you know, some of the studies showed as well. So with all these facts emerging, I think there has been now decline in the neonatal community in using surfactant, and declining from the need for intubation, and you can see that as well. And, you know, the conventional ventilation as well, it decreases by gestational age, and if you compare it with previously all babies who were 30 weaker or 32 weaker, they would have, you know, some time to spend some time on the ventilator. Now, now there are new guidelines and new guidelines for the use of surfactant. And, you know, it's really nice to see that we have the, you know, both European consensus guidelines for 2017 as well as the Canadian guidelines as well for 2017. And you know what? They are speaking both the same language. And I want just to run it by you, and I know this part is not about surfactant, but it's a very important part that we always ignore in our practices, which is the antenatal steroid use. I know there is a variation from one unit to another, but it's very important. You're always having a problem with antenatal steroids. They are a broad use for it in all preterm less than 34 weaker, less than 26 weaker, between 34 to 36 gestation as well, and this is all with a level A1. Now, in the elective C-section, which I don't know whether it's a problem in your unit, but it's a big problem in our unit. I mean, we have those early, you know, late FREEM that they are occupying a lot of beds with a lot of morbidities, ventilation, and, you know, and some of them, they need actually mechanical ventilation, unfortunately. So here, they also, you know, kind of recommend the use of corticosteroids. Optimal treatment to delivery interval is more than 24 hours and less than 7 days. Antenatal steroids can be considered for C-section, not in labor, up to 39 weeks, which is another problem, because the C-section rates, I know all over the kingdom, is going up. Some rates is up to 40%. A single repeat course of antenatal steroids, if the first course was diminished more than 1 to 2 weeks in less than 32 to 34 weeks gestation with a level of A2. And mothers, of course, we don't have centralization, but I wish we have. We always talk about it. But, you know, a preemie lady, a lady who's carrying a prem, should not be delivering in a level one or level two hospital. Yes, we can intubate. Yes, we can put lines, but it doesn't mean that we are delivering an optimum care for this baby. So I wish we are able to have a referral you know, and you know, kind of different levels and where babies should go. Single repeat course of antenatal steroids may be appropriate if the first course was administered more than 1 to 2 weeks. Now we come to the surfactant therapy. Please read it with me because I was a bit confused. I'm trying to change our recommendation, and it's just I find that there is a lot of vagueness in it. And, you know, you have to take it with a pinch of salt, and you have to look into your own unit and or practices. For example, recommendation, it should be surfactant should be given for babies with RDS, should be given all natural surfactant, which is level A1. A policy of earlier rescue surfactant should be there. Surfactant should be administered in the delivery room if intubation for stabilization is required. Babies with RDS should be given rescue surfactant early. A protocol would be to treat babies if they are less or equal 26 weeks gestation with FIO2 more than 0.3, and if they are more than 26 weeks when FIO2 requirement is more than 0.4. And the proactant alpha in initial dose of 200 milligram is better than 100 milligram. And then it goes to that ensure for infants who are failing on CPAP, missed as an alternative to ensure for spontaneously breathing infant. A second and a third dose of surfactant should be administered if there is evidence of ongoing RDS. Surfactant can be used for RDS complicated by congenital pneumonia, and surfactant therapy can be used to improve oxygenation following pulmonary hemorrhage. So now, for me, I find a lot of that, there is a lot of vagueness. So when we say failing CPAP, how we define failing CPAP? When I decide to give to give babies rescue, is it like earlier rescue? We know that earlier rescue is better than the late. So what would be the criteria? You know, and if you look in the different studies and even the studies that they built, you know, their recommendation on, you don't find there is homogeneity. And you find like each one has a different criteria for what they consider to do a rescue. And so it's the same thing with the Canadian as well. If you look at it, it's exactly the same. The one difference that I find it is that infants who are at significant risk for RDS should receive prophylactic natural surfactant therapy as soon as they are stable within a few minutes after intubation. Okay, so significant risk for RDS, what are they? Are they by gestational age? Are they by weight? Are they by predisposing factors? You know, it's kind of vague. For me, at least for my understanding, it is vague. And here we have that, you know, the same thing, they go about the retreatment as well. And then after prophylactic surfactant therapy, rapid weaning and extubation to CPAP within 1 hour. Okay, so if we look at it, what I could gather from all of this is just we have to kind of be very careful with the use of surfactant. We should not offer it to everybody because we know that it's good. But the problem with the surfactant is the way that we are giving it. We need to intubate babies, and we need to bag them. Okay. So, and, you know, some of the babies, if you manage them well with CPAP, they might not need surfactant. I think Colombia have shown that long time ago, and they've utilization of surfactant was one of the lowest in the comparing them with the Vermont Oxford. So what I've gathered from that nutrients in surfactant administration is when surfactant should be given, maybe less than 29 weeks gestational age. Maybe it should be given prophylactic in the DR. You know, risk factors, then if there is risk factors, then we'll do it prophylactically as well. If there are more than 29 weeks of gestational age, then we're going to wait till their FIO2 requirement is more than 0.4. And in this way, you know, at least we have, you know, some kind of ground to work around it. How to prevent the surfactant administration now? We are in the era how to prevent surfactant administration rather than giving surfactant is to have a gentle approach in the DR management, prevent ventilation, and prevent prenatal infection. And if surfactant should be given, we should give it possibly without ventilation. We can use, you know, while the baby is breathing on CPAP, we can introduce a tube directly into the trachea by the MIST method or the LISA method, and, you know, inject and just infusing the surfactant as the baby just, you know, breathing on the CPAP. I've seen videos, and it didn't look very easy for me, but, you know, I was assured by one of the professors who presented the data that it's very easy and, you know, it's just the daily practice. So we've decided in our unit to give it a try. And hopefully when we come back, when I go back, then we're going to put a policy for it. And there has been a lot of talk about using nebulized surfactant. And unfortunately, there has been a meta-analysis, and we're not yet there. But that would be the best. That would be... excuse me. Sorry. That would be the best solution with CPAP. So for me, I think there is a plethora of articles of meta-analysis and so on. I think what we need before we kind of jump into adopting it, I think we have to see whether we walk the walk and talk the talk as well. So we have to look at our own data. We have to see, as Dr. Elhani said, what is our incidence of bronchopulmonary dysplasia? What is the pattern of ventilation? We have to look at our OB population. I mean, I could tell you that we have 25% unbooked mums, and our rate of uptake of antenatal steroids varies from 65 up to 85 on a yearly basis. You know, we have to look into our DR management. DR management, are we doing NeoPuff? And, you know, I thought we have NeoPuff and everybody's doing NeoPuff. But when we actually gathered the data, and Dr. Amna did a great job at that, she was a fellow with us, and now she's a consultant, so proud of her. Anyway, it showed that actually new buff is used only 40% in babies. Then also we have to look at, you know, at the culture of the unit. I mean, we keep talking about Columbia and also now at George Washington. I think it's all, it's a culture. It's people believe in the same system and they do it, whether it's the OB, our friendly enemies, you know, midwives, everybody is on the same wavelength. And that's how you are, you'll be successful in doing anything. But if, you know, if the round today is this consultant is on service, and then things change according to the consultant on service, then I don't think you're going to be able to achieve much. And that's why we have to limit our variation. And then we have to be honest, who's covering the DR? Who's covering the DR in the middle of the night? It's not the consultant. It's, you know, yes, doctors who are assigned to the NICU, but they are not consultant yet. So that's why you have to have a very clear guidelines, and that guidelines should be coming from your unit, from your data, from your patient, from the level of the expertise of your doctor, and then, you know, everybody decide on it in order to limit the variation, and then you have to, we have to use the PDCA cycle in order to achieve the target. I think that's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mayab Saud, for your interesting talk.